Well, good morning, everyone. Good to see you all this morning. Welcome to North Baptist Church. Certainly our privilege to welcome you here. We've got a great day. We are celebrating Memorial Day. We certainly want to pay tribute to those loved ones, those in the military that have given their lives so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we enjoy today. So we're certainly excited about that. We have a special treat for you today from the Faith Builders class that I know you'll enjoy. We're also excited today to have missionary Steve Ziner with Bearing Precious Seed Global with us this morning, and he'll be preaching to us. Before we sing, I want to read to you out of Numbers chapter 10, starting in verse 1. The Bible says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Make thee two trumpets of silver. Of a whole piece shalt thou make them, that thou mayest use them for the calling of the assembly, and for the journeying of the camps. And when they shall blow with them, all the assembly shall assemble themselves to thee at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And if they blow but with one trumpet, then the princes, which are heads of the thousands of Israel, shall gather themselves unto thee. When ye blow an alarm, then the camps that lie on the east parts shall go forward. When ye blow an alarm the second time, then the camps that lie on the south side shall take their journey. They shall blow an alarm for their journeys. But when the congregation is to be gathered together, ye shall blow, but ye shall not sound an alarm. And the sons of Aaron, the priests, shall blow with the trumpet, and they shall be to you for an ordinance forever throughout your generations. And if ye go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresseth you, then ye shall blow an alarm with the trumpets. Ye shall be remembered before the Lord your God, and ye shall be saved from your enemies. Also in the day of your gladness, and in your solemn days, and in the beginnings of your months, ye shall blow with the trumpets over your burnt offerings and over the sacrifices of your peace offerings, that they may be to you for a memorial before your God. I am the Lord your God." Gary, you will.
And with that scripture, let's sing hymn number 19, "Be Exalted, O God." And also put your finger in 122, "O God, our help in ages past." Shall we stand together, please?
Thank you.
Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you that you are the God of all gods. You are the King of all kings. You are the creator of the universe. You are the sustainer. You are the giver of life. God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the plans you have in place for us. Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who loved us so much that he was willing to leave heaven to come to this earth and die on an old rugged cross, willing to shed his own blood so that we might have eternal life. Lord, we thank you that he was willing to pay for our sins. God, how I pray if there's someone here today that does not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, that this might be that very day, that the power of the Holy Spirit would do that convicting work. That if there's one here today that cannot remember that time when they have asked the Lord to forgive them of their sins and to come into their heart, take up residence and be their Savior, God, how I pray that would happen today. Lord, for all those of us that do know you, may we be a living testimony of your goodness and your love and your mercy and your grace. God, as we think about Memorial Day, Father, we thank you for the privilege we have of remembering those, whether they be friends or loved ones, or certainly those who have served in our military that have given their lives in the call of duty so that we might enjoy the freedoms that we have today. God, how I pray that we would spend the remainder of this weekend focusing on those who gave the ultimate sacrifice so that we could enjoy life here in this country today. Father, I pray for those that are still serving at this very moment that you would protect our men and women in uniform, that you would keep them safe, that you would help them to know that there is a cause worth fighting for, and that there is a country that loves them and supports them. So God, I pray that you would be with our military men and women today. Be with our leaders. Be with our officials. Lord, I pray that you would be with our president today. May he have a godly wisdom and not an earthly wisdom. Lord, for those who make laws and pass laws, may they have a godly wisdom and not an earthly wisdom. Lord, I pray for leaders in our country today that will do what's right for the good of the entire nation and not just a few individuals. But Lord, we thank you today that we can pause and remember and celebrate those who have given their lives so that we might be the country that we are today. Lord, I thank you for our missionary here today, Steve Ziner, and the work that he is doing to get the Bible out to countries and languages that have no Bible. God, I pray that you would bless his work many times over. And Lord, we look forward to his message this morning. God, how I pray for everyone that's here today that have needs, burdens, and issues, that God, you would meet that every need, and that you would be that comforter that we know you are. God, we love you. May everything we say and do today be a blessing to you, and we'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Sing the Lord. There's a pride deep inside of you. Lift your voice on high for everyone to hear. Sing along, America.
That. I want to say good morning to all of you. Welcome to North Baptist Church. If this is your first time here, it's certainly our privilege to welcome you to our service this morning. And hopefully when you walked in, you received a visitor's packet. If you would fill that out and drop it in the offering plate here in just a few minutes, we'd certainly appreciate you being here. On a personal note, good to have my parents here, Stanley and Janet Meese from Indiana, for graduation services, and my sister Jennifer and her fiancé, Steve Dreyer, here. They'll be leaving here and heading back to Indiana, but it's been good to have them here to see Maddie's graduation and Caleb Brown's graduation this past Friday night. And in 2 weeks, we will be having a special graduation service. And so we certainly would love to have all of you here for that. Quickly, by way of announcements, if you'll look in your bulletin, you'll see the activities for this week. Again, you'll notice there's not much going on in the gym floor there. Hopefully, next Sunday, we will have regular use of the floor without any worries of damaging it or anything like that. So if you can bear with us today, we would certainly appreciate that. But we are about to wrap up our building project. You can see the curbs have been poured and the islands for the new parking lot. And so we're very, very close to being finished. So we appreciate your thoughtfulness in what we've got going on. Tonight, I hope you'll be here for our 6 o'clock service. At the end of the service, we'll be having our monthly business meeting, but it's always in the month of May that we elect our officers for the following year, so we'll certainly be doing that this evening in our business meeting as well, so we hope that you'll be here for that. The church will be empty tomorrow. There will be no one here for because of Memorial Day. If you need me for any reason, or Pastor Aaron, you can catch us on our cell phones. Then you'll see Tuesday morning, men's breakfast and Bible study down at Valley Coney Island. Fellas, we certainly appreciate if you could be there Tuesday morning at 8:30. And then you can also see all of the other activities going on through the end of the week. Don't forget, on your way out, if you can pick up a baby bottle for the Crisis Pregnancy Services, fill that up with your pennies and nickels and dimes, and then bring that back on Father's Day. And that's certainly a wonderful way to help the causes and efforts at Flint Crisis Pregnancy Services. Also, Bible school is coming up very soon, June 17th through the 20th. If you would like to help us out with Bible school, there's sign-up sheets out on the back bulletin board. And I know that you will be a blessing to the kids, and certainly to those that are heading up Bible school. We'd love to have you help out for that. Also coming up very soon, June the 10th through the 13th, we will be putting Bibles together, as we did last year for Bearing Precious Seed. We'll have about two or three different time shifts during the day for you to come and help out with that, and we're certainly looking forward to that. I think that's it as far as announcements. We're going to ask our young people if they would head to the back. We're going to collect our kids' coins. This is an opportunity for you to help our kids go to camp this summer. As we said, we're sending about close to 50 people to camp this summer, and it is expensive. And so if you can help make their trip a little bit more affordable, we would certainly appreciate that, all right? So ladies, if you would please. Back up to the front, drop them here in the basket, and we'll certainly appreciate that. Anybody we miss? All right, got some in the back there. kids bring these backs right up there and drop them in the offering plate. I would love to lead you in that song, but I am now 0 for 2. I have no clue what that one was either. Wonderful Jesus. Boy, you all need to find a new pastor, and quick. I didn't know last Sunday's song or today's. Can't help me out on that one. What is today?
Sunday.
Yes. Whose birthday is it?
My daddy's birthday.
And he's 47?
No, he's 30.
He's 30. You want to tell him happy birthday?
Happy birthday, Daddy.
All right. Gentlemen, if you would please come. We'll have our morning offering. If you can be here tonight for our business meeting, you can see how the business of the church works. You can see how God is blessing our church. So we certainly invite you for the services this evening. Kirk, if you would please, sir.
That's Praise Ye the Triune God. And I was just trying to look it up because there are some words in there. The choir sung this piece and it talks about ye old men and children. And Jamar, I thought of you now. And at the hugely ripe old age of 37, I hardly know what to say. Most of us would agree you're not in that category yet. But Anyway, congratulations to a number of you who've had birthdays both today and during the course of this month. So we congratulate all of you. Little reminder, the choir, in spite of the fact that it's a holiday weekend, will be practicing at 5 today. So if you should be part of that, please do plan to attend. Let's sing 641, shall we? America the Beautiful. 641, let's stand together as we sing.
The prison. prisoner, the powerless, the slave have always known it. There's something that keeps reaching for the sky. Begins because a baby fights for freedom, and songs we love to sing have freedom's theme. Some have walked through fire and flood to find a place of freedom, and some faced hell itself for freedom's dream. Let freedom ring wherever minds know what it means to be in chains. Let into every fiber of creation, and he meant for us to all be free and whole.
Thank you, young people. We appreciate that. They are going to be doing an encore presentation come Veterans Day, and we're going to have a great service then, but they wanted to do something today for Memorial Day, and you guys just did terrific. Thank you, Linda, for your help with that class. We just love them to pieces. It is certainly our privilege this morning to have with us missionary Steve Ziner with Bearing Precious Seeds Global Ministries, and he is heavy into Bible translating, trying to get the gospel, getting the Bible to where unknown nations have no knowledge of God's word at all. So we're excited to hear what he has for us. Brother Steve, if you would, please.
Thank you, Pastor. It is a great honor, as I mentioned in Sunday school, to be here with you this morning. And I do salute all of our military. I'm so thankful for their dedication, their surrendered lives. Many of you have served faithfully and with great honor. I remember my wife's uncle went to fight in North Korea. Many times when I travel to Korea, I think about him. And he was 17 years old, not quite 17, born in Cincinnati, and he said, I'm going to go into the military and fight in Korea. So he went to sign up, and they said, you're too young. No, he said, I'm 18 years old. He said, I was born in West Virginia, and the courthouse burned down. And that's the type of dedication that some of those had. And he did pay the ultimate sacrifice, because in North Korea, he died. He gave his life. My son-in-law, who fought in Iraq and fought in Afghanistan first and then into Iraq as an Army Ranger, married our youngest daughter, Christina. He was blown up over in Iraq early in the war, but survived, but three of his comrades did not survive. And I do remember going to that memorial service there in Fort Benning, Georgia, and telling Kyle's father, I'm so glad that we are sitting on the second row, not the first row. And I was much pleased at how our military honored the family members of those heroes. And so as the pastor was praying for them, I thought about that. And I want them to know that here is one citizen of the United States that loves them and appreciates them dearly. And I am thankful for the sacrifice that they made and make, and the sacrifice that you have made in serving our country. And so we do honor our veterans. If you have your Bibles, turn with me, please, to the book of Ruth, chapter 1. As you're turning to the book of Ruth, chapter 1, please find on my table back there a prayer card. Please take one of those. I desperately, desperately, desperately need your prayer. We had all of the finances in the world. It would mean nothing if we did not have prayers. If I have my choice, I'm taking the prayers. And I'm taking the churches that will stand behind His Word. So please, please, we ask that you would pray for Bearing Precious Seed Global Bible Translators. As we are translating the Word of God, we're working in many countries. At this time, we are working on the Chinese New Translation, the Eson. These are two Bibles on the table after the service. This is a very first edition of any kind for 24 million people. The New Testament is finished. We'll be printing that at the end of this year. This is the Telugu New Testament. We'll be printing the whole Bible here shortly. So stop by, talk with me. I'd be happy to answer any of the questions that you might have. Please take one of these books. There's five questions here that the man on the street will ask. Who is God? How did I get here? What happened to man? What's my relationship with Jesus Christ? And the ultimate question is heaven real? These can be a great tool for you in your witnessing effort to get the Word of God. God said His Word would not return void. There's 540 verses of scriptures. There's no commentary, my commentary in here. We just went through the scriptures from Genesis to the book of Revelation. Go to our website. You'll find this book in Spanish. You'll find it in the new simplified Chinese translation. And you will find it in French. And also pray for us as we have an open door in Africa, starting a new translation center on that continent. I'm very excited. That is not just to send translators there to translate a particular language, but to send our translators there, Brother Jesse McCoy and others that are working with us, to train nationals who already speak the language, who already have theological training, to train them how to translate the Bible for their own people. And please be in much prayer about that. The book of Ruth, chapter 1 and verse 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled, that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons Mahlon and Chilion, Ephraites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. And Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one was Orpha, the name of the other Ruth, and they dwelled there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them, and the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. Then she arose and went with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-laws with her, and they went on the way to return unto the land of Judah. And Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, go, return each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as ye have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that ye may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice and wept. And they said unto her, surely we will return with thee unto thy people. And Naomi said, turn again, my daughters. Why will ye go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb, that they may be your husbands? Turn again, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have an husband. If I should say, I have hope, if I should have an husband also tonight, and should also bear sons, would ye tarry for them till they were grown? Would ye stay for them from having husbands? Nay, my daughters, for it grieveth me much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord is gone out against me. They lifted up their voice and wept again, and Orpha kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. And she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee, for whither thou goest I will go, and where thou lodgest I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest will I die, and there will I be buried, and the Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. When she saw that she was steadfastly minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. And they two went until they came to Bethlehem. And it came to pass, when they were come to Bethlehem, that all the city was moved about them. And they said, is this Naomi? She said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara. For the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord hath brought me home again empty. Why then call ye me Naomi, seeing The Lord hath testified against me, and the Almighty hath afflicted me. So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, the daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of barley harvest. Notice with me in verse 7. The Bible says, wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was. I want to speak to you briefly this morning on that subject. I don't know where you are this morning, and I'm not talking about the address, the physical address of this church. I don't know where you are spiritually. We see ups and downs in this chapter. We find here that Naomi sees the hand of God and has enough discernment to return back to Bethlehem, Judah. But as she returns back to Bethlehem, Judah, we see that she is grieved. She said, I went out full, but now I come back empty. I don't know where you are today. Maybe death is knocking at your door. Maybe you have family members that are discouraged or disheartened and going through some great trials and testings. Maybe you are wavering in a decision, a spiritual decision that you must make. You're not sure which way to go. I think this message is for you this morning, and I pray that you'll listen as we preach and expound upon it. Father, speak to our hearts. Open up our minds, our eyes, and our ears. Help us to see, hear, and understand what you have for us. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Here is a little family. Father, mother, and their two sons that according to their given names seems to be sickly. They live in a place called Bethlehem, Judah. Bethlehem meaning house of bread, and Judah meaning praise. Kind of contrary to the circumstance with the great famine that was in the land. Is this the place of bread, and is this the place of praise? You ever been like that in your home? Most of the time you're home, happy, everything's going well, and then all of a sudden there's some great trials or testings going through, and it doesn't seem like a happy place any longer. So they're going to sojourn. They're going to live temporarily from the house of bread and praise to the country of Moab because of the famine in the land. The story begins in Bethlehem, Judah, and it will end back up in that place. This little book of Ruth, containing only four little chapters, gives us the genealogy that leads to the Lord Jesus. It is the connecting factor between the house of David and the tribe of Judah. Very important book. It is here in this little book with love story that we find the great doctrine of redemption. Only possible through the kinsman redeemer. Only God can redeem. So it was necessary for him to become man. Little did this family know, as they left Bethlehem, Judah, and journeyed down the road and headed in the direction of Moab, little did they know that all of heaven and God was taking notice of their journey. Little did they know that this morning we would read about them. And you might say, well, nobody knows about me. Nobody knows about my circumstances. Nobody knows about my trials. God does. And he's taking notice. And he cares for you. Nobody knows about my sin. My sin is secret. God knows about your sin. Nobody knows about my worries. God knows about your worries. Oh, I've told everybody that I'm pretty sure that if I were to die, I'd go to heaven. God knows whether you're born again or not. You see, we can't fool God. So God is watching over this family. He cares for them. He wants to do something in their lives. We must never forget that God cares for us. Now remember, this was the time of the judges. And according to the book of Judges, just the book previous to Ruth, we find that there was no king in Israel, and every man did that which was right in their own eyes. It was terrible, terrible times in the land. There was religious apostasy and moral awfulness and political anarchy. Kind of sound like our country? Very difficult times. Their travels takes them down to Moab. The name Moab means washpot. I mean, it's the garbage pit of the world. Who in the world would want to go to Moab and raise a family? Well, let me tell you who would go to Moab and raise a family. A missionary family would go to Moab and raise a family. Why would you want to take your children and go to a God-forsaken place, as we might think that it is? Because it is a forsaken place. And there are people there that need to come to know Christ as their Savior. And God puts it in the heart of a man and his wife to go and to minister and to take their children there. Why would you expose your children to all of that? As I travel around the world, I've been to Iraq, I've been to Cuba, I've been all over South America, all over Asia, to China, all of these different places, now to Africa. Some people say, Brother Ziner, don't you realize that it's dangerous to go to those places? You need to curtail your travels. Listen, it's dangerous to stay home. Have you not read the papers lately? This country, people are dying all the time. They're getting shot. Sometimes I feel it's safer over there. I wish you could travel with me to Kurdistan. I felt like it was one of the safest places on the face of the earth. I'm telling you, those Kurds who Hussein tried to gas and to destroy, they have an expression. They told me what their expression was. Said, Brother Ziner, you see those mountains over there? I said, yes. We have an expression. The Kurds have an expression that the only friends that the Kurds have are those mountains. Because when we're in danger, we flee to the mountains and the mountains rescue us. And yet they're fighting for their freedom. And just a handful of Christians that are there in that nation. And so, who wants to go to Moab? Who are these people? Remember, these are the descendants of Lot in Genesis chapter 19. In Genesis 19, Lot, who had had an incestuous relationship with his daughter, and she conceived and had a son by the name of Moab. They were wicked, wicked people. Here we find Naomi and her husband, two children living in that place. So Elimelech dies. Tragedy hits. And it's not long that tragedy hits again, and her two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, die also. What a tragedy. It seems like there's no hope, and here is Naomi living in Moab, and what hope does she have? You ever spoken to somebody like that? I have. You give them a gospel tract, or you give them a John and Romans, or you give them a message or a word of consolation or a word of hope, and they look you in the eyes and they say, I feel like I'm hopeless. I feel like there's no hope. But God doesn't care that if I were to die right now, I don't know where I would go. Then we gladly open up the scriptures, the word of God, which says it will not return void. And we share God's good news with them. And not all of them, but some of them start to listen. And it's not long. They're born into the family of God. And that hopelessness that they felt now has been changed. It vanishes away. And now they have all the hope of eternal life. Let's notice briefly, just for a few moments, some things about Naomi. Oh, this is a wonderful book. Please read this book. It'll bless your heart. But I want to focus in a little bit this morning on Naomi. First of all, Naomi recognized the right supply. When she said, wherefore, she went forth out of the place where she was. They had lived there some 10 years because there was a famine. But after all of this tragedy, all of a sudden she hears the good news that God has blessed Bethlehem, Judah. Now God has a plan for Naomi. God has a plan for Ruth. God has a plan for all 7+ billion people on the face of the earth. He's created us with a free will. If we will accept that, He has a plan. He had a plan for Ruth and He had a plan for Naomi. He wanted Naomi and Ruth back in Bethlehem, Judah. Now, how in the world is He going to get Naomi and Ruth back in Judah? Well, He blessed all of Bethlehem, Judah. The farmers went out to sow the seed as they had done in the previous years, only to find out that they received so very little. They said maybe this was the last seed that they had. They went out and sowed the seed. And then they said, "Oh, God in heaven, Jehovah, give us rain." And all of a sudden, the rain came. Not a flooding rain. It was a rain like they've never seen before in their lives. It was a perfect rain. And then the sun came out. And the sun shined on those crops, and the crops started to grow. And when those crops needed a little bit more water, when they got thirsty, God sent the rain again. It was a bumper crop. They had never seen anything like this before. What are you trying to say, Brother Ziner? I'm trying to say that God will move mountains to get you in the center of His will. He blessed Bethlehem, Judah, to get Naomi to come back. What has He done in your life? Oh, if we had time, I'd love to tell you about my uncle that died in Korea. I'd love to tell you the full story of that, about his life insurance money that was left to my mother-in-law. Oh, I'd love to tell you through all of that, through all of those circumstances, they moved right next door to this Catholic boy. And she witnessed to me, and that's how I got saved. But she had never moved there. She had lived in the slums of Cincinnati, because her husband was just a drunk and they had nothing but that little bit of money and that sergeant that came to say, "Take this money, take a lump sum, buy a house out in the country, get out of this place, and then we'll give you money every month to make the payment of that house." And she did that. God moved them around several places. You see, what has God done in your life? Has He done anything like that in your life? Well, sure He has. It wasn't an accident that you got saved. You had a desire to get saved. You wanted to get saved. And God put the message right before you. I think there's got to be people around the world that are waiting for that message. So God sends the missionaries. She recognized the right supply. It was a spiritual source. It came from God. It was a sufficient source. My salvation that God has provided for me is sufficient. I don't need to add anything to it. I don't need to take anything away from it. It's sufficient. So what God has given me is sufficient. She recognized the right steps. She headed in that place. She said, "I've got to leave the place where I'm at." So she started heading in the right direction. Now, what's the right direction for you? The best direction to go is in God's will, in His plan and His purpose. Get into the Word of God. Get into church. Listen. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. He will speak to you. Brother Ziner, I don't know. I've never experienced that. Why don't you ask Him for the first time to speak to you? And then you can experience it also. I'm not saying that the lights will blink and all of a sudden you'll hear this audible voice. But I'm going to tell you, He'll fill your heart with joy and peace and contentment like you've never had before when you seek His love and seek His will and seek His plan. She headed in the right direction. She was willing to make that step. Now, where are you today? What step do you need to make? Thirdly, she recognized the right sacrifice. Now, she had lost her two sons. She had lost her husband. How was Naomi going to live financially? She had lost everything. She had two daughter-in-laws. She really, really needed those two daughter-in-laws to take care of her. But what did she say to those two daughter-in-laws? Go back to your family. You're young. Go back to your home. There will be somebody that will marry you in this place, in Moab, and raise up children and take care of you. Now, did Naomi need these two girls? Sure she did. But Naomi was willing to make the sacrifice. She said, I love you, I care for you, and this was great love that they had. She was willing to make that sacrifice. She was willing to give that up. Ruth said no. Naomi said, well, your sister is going back. No. Your God will be my God. Where you die, I'll die. Where you live, I will live. She had a great convert because she wasn't just following Naomi. She was following Naomi's God. And Naomi had made that sacrifice and saw how that God supplied. She didn't want somebody that was just going to follow them, because who in the world is going to marry these two girls down in Bethlehem, Judah? I don't know. I don't understand how her two sons married them. But taking these two girls back to Bethlehem, Judah, who's going to marry a Moabite? The garbage pit of the world. Who would do that? You might think this morning, does God really care for me? Oh, I know He cares for the pastor because he's a godly man. I know He cares for so-and-so because they seem to really walk with God. I know He loves the missionaries because they take the Bible around the world. And I'm just not sure that God really cares for me. But you're mistaken. He does care. The Bible said that He came to seek and to save that which is lost. Who is lost? All of us. He came to seek and to save us and to become our Father and to love us and to care for us and cherish us and build in us and nourish us from the Word of God and carry us on until He comes back or until we die. But Brother Zino, you don't understand the trials that I go through. He does. On Facebook, I have friends around the world that I communicate with. And for me, it's a wonderful tool to keep in touch with friends that I've made around the world. And some of them are going through horrendous problems. Next week, I need your prayer. My wife will go through a horrendous surgery next Monday morning, a week from tomorrow. And we pray for one another. And we say, oh, God, help us. He does. So don't think that He only cares for somebody else. Do you know why you say that? Because you might not be living with Him like you should. But maybe you need to leave the place where you are and say, I'm going to leave this stagnant place. I'm going to leave this place of lack of prayer and Bible reading and lack of spiritual growth in my life, and I'm going to serve God. Or maybe this morning, if you were to die right now, you'd have no assurance that you'd go to heaven. And you need to leave that place where you are right now, that place of worry, doubt, fear, and no security, and come to the cross and say, Jesus, give me eternal life. Where are you today? She recognized the right separation. Will you recognize the right separation? You might think, well, the world is my friend for all eternity. The world will leave you behind. You might think, well, I've got friends and they'll see me through. I'm amazed that, listen, nothing is strange nowadays. Nothing. We see almost anything and everything. And people marching, hell is great. I can't wait to get there. You got to be kidding me. Who would even think that? Who would even say that? And yet, there are people that do that today. We worship Satan. We're going to have a great party when we get to hell. I mean, those were only things 30, 40 years ago that if preacher would have stood and said that, well, who? They got to be nuts to say something like that. And yet, turn on the TV and you'll see it. We live in strange times. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, we live in perilous times. These are the days. Where are you this morning? Is there a place where you need to leave and head back to Bethlehem, Judah, house of bread, a place of praise, and leave the garbage pit of this world? I fear for my grandchildren, but only just a click away from something that may scar them for life. You know what I'm talking about. Please come. We must cast ourselves before God, so God, help us. Bless our churches. Help our churches be strong. Help us to leave the place, complacency where we've been. Follow you with all of your hearts. Let's all stand. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, let me ask you just a couple questions and then I'll pray and then turn it over to the pastor. Is there someone here this morning that said, "Preacher, God spoke to my heart this morning. I'm kind of like Naomi. I'm in a place, but really it's not bringing happiness, contentment, and peace. And I need to leave this place. I need to leave that place and head off in the right direction. Preacher, don't call out my name, and I wouldn't even if I knew it. Preacher, would you pray for me? Just look up. God bless you. God bless you all of this congregation. God bless you. God bless you. Might there be someone who say, "Preacher, pray for me. I'm definitely in the wrong place. If I were to die right now, I've never been saved. I've never been born again. I've never asked Jesus to come into my heart and save me. If I were to die right now, I think I'd go to hell. I didn't need to leave this position, this place where I'm at. Would you pray for me, preacher? Just look at me. I don't want to die anymore. I want to go to heaven with God. I'm in the wrong position, the wrong place. Father, I thank you for this church. Lord, this church is trying to stay in the right direction, the right position, preaching your word, loving your word, ministering one to another, sending the word, sending the missionaries around the world to duplicate this place in other places. God bless them, encourage them, meet their needs. Lord, I pray that this lighthouse would even grow to become a greater lighthouse in this city, in this community, and around this world. Give them a desire and a fervor to keep on going like they've never had before. Bless them, Father. Bless this invitation. I pray that your will would be accomplished in it. I ask you in Jesus' name.
Just before Gary leads us in our invitation, you know, the interesting thing about this sermon today is that God knows where He wants you to be. He knows who He wants you to be. He will tell you who He wants you to be and where He wants you to go. But He'll never force you. That's just not the way He works. And so we may just sit here where we're at for the rest of our lives. Woe is me, woe is me. Well, that's certainly not where God wants you to be. But once He gives us the invitation, we have to respond. If not, He'll just let us stay where we're at. So I appreciate the message this morning, and I hope that the Holy Spirit will do that work in your heart and life. If there are problems and struggles and situations in your life right now, maybe it's because you're not willing to go where God wants you to be. God, Gary, would you have our invitation?
Please turn to hymn number 535. I am thine, O Lord, 535.
Some information there, and he'll certainly be able to answer any and all of your questions. We'll certainly appreciate having him here today, and certainly all of you this morning. If there's anything that we can do for you this week, please let us know. And as we are dismissed in prayer, Brother Doyle, if you would please.